Good evening, everyone. I would like to welcome everyone to the webinar UGC NAAC Accreditation Strategies in Institutions, organized by IQAC of MES College Erimeli. MES College Erimeli, the very first United College under Muslim Education Society, started in 1995 with 3 UG courses. But now it has 7 UG courses and 7 PG courses and around 1,500 students. We are planning to go for the accreditation process on 2021. And with this aim in mind, apart from the hostile conditions, we are hosting this webinar. Today, we have here with us our chief guest and resource person, Dr. M.M. Manoharan, sir, professor in the Department of Statistics, University of Calicut. Mahin M.M., sir, principal of MES College, Erimeli. Mrs. Rama Devi, a vice principal and IQAC coordinator. Dr. Ashok Kumar, sir, MES Research Forum Director, Mr. Jidesh K.S., CDC Director, Mr. Sabjan Yusuf, IT Cell Director, Tanseem, Jinish, Anandu, and Jace John, Technical Coordinators, and above all, participants from all over India. Let's start the program by a warm welcome from our Vice Principal and IQAC Coordinator, Mrs. Rama Devi A. Over to you, Madam.
Thank you, Shiba. Good evening, all. This is Rama Devi A, IQAC coordinator of MES College, Erimeli. IQAC organizes a series of national and international webinars in our college. This is the 10th webinar in this series. I consider it as a privilege to welcome you all to this wonderful session. Quality is as important as quantity. This is more than true in the case of education. Identifying this need, UGC initiated IQAC in universities and all affiliated higher educational institutions. As part of this, IQAC of our college is also very active in maintaining quality of the institution. NAAC introduced revised accreditation framework, and we are eager to know more about it. Also, we must be aware of the latest developments in higher education and accreditation process. With this in mind, IQAC of our college organizes this webinar. Now, I move on to my duty of welcoming you all. Today's chief guest, Dr. Manoharan, M.M. Manoharan, Professor, Department of Statistics, University of Calicut. His achievements in academics are quite impressive. He was first rank holder in MSc Statistics, and since then, his career graph is steadily moving up. I am quite happy that he is my senior in QSAT and feel proud to welcome him to this webinar. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
Our principal, Maheen Amman sir, is the inspiration behind all our activities. Thank you, sir, for your support. And with all respect, I welcome Maheen sir to this webinar. Welcome, sir. Dr. Ashok Kumar, the director of Research Forum, is the prime motivator and inspiration of all activities.
Hello.
On behalf of IQAC, I wholeheartedly welcome Ashok sir to this webinar. I gratefully mention the effort taken by Subjan Yusuf, Director of IT Cell, Jidesh KS, Director of CDC, and all members of IT Cell. I welcome all of you to this webinar. Now, I use this opportunity to welcome Sheba Michael, Dean of Student Welfare, and Hari Krishnan, Coordinator. Finally, I welcome most important and most beloved participants to this webinar. An enthusiastic welcome to each and every participant. Once again, I welcome one and all present here. Have a fruitful session. Thank you all.
Thank you, Madam. I think there occurs some technical problem for our principal. So may I request Dr. Ashok Kumar sir, MES Research Forum Director, for the giving the introduction to our resource person. May I request Ashok Kumar sir. Over to you, Ashok Kumar sir.
Thank you, Sheba Michael ma'am. Good evening to one and all present here today on behalf of IQSC and MES College. I am glad to introduce the resource person of this webinar, Dr. M. Manokaran, Professor, Department of Statistics in Calicut University. Mr. Manokaran, who completed his pre-degree course and MSc and PhD. He has achieved more than 72 papers of statistics and more than 92 contributed the webinars in national and international level. He's also produced 13 plus PhD scholars under his successful guidance and 10 MPhil students from his guidance also. He's also the board of studies members in more than universities like in Calicut University, Kannur University, Cochin University, Periyar University in Tamil Nadu, University of Mysore, University of Madras, and Pondicherry University and Mangalore Universities. He is also the NAC coordinator of next accreditation. We are happy to say this. And he is also the appointed as a UGC coordinator also. He also successfully completed UGC major projects and received some monetary benefits from national and international level. We are honored and happy by your presence on this webinar, sir. Over to you, Sheba Michael, ma'am.
Thank you, sir, for the valuable information. May I request our beloved principal, Maheen Amman, sir, to inaugurate this function. Over to you, sir.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Manoharan sir. Thank you all.
Good evening.
I am happy to present with you this evening in connection with the webinar based on the topic UGC NAC Accreditation Strategies in Institutions conducted by IQAC of our college. We have already conducted 3 international and 8 national webinars on different topics during this period of COVID-19. I feel proud to say that our college is ready to cooperate with the UGC in its efforts to face the new challenges faced in the field of higher education. We conduct this webinar on the topic UGC NAC Accreditation Strategies in Institutions in order to encourage other institutions to organize similar programs, and it will help them to achieve NAC accreditation for the college. In this contest, I remember that the statement of the famous historian Henri Toynbee that the existence of humanity is based on the theory of challenge and response. It means that has to face many challenges in this life, and his success depends on how he overcome it with the courage. Now the whole world is facing a challenge in the form of COVID-19. We have to defeat it and solve the problem raised. This webinar is the part of our effort. I wish all success for the webinar and congratulate the organizers, Mrs. Nadir Kadera, MES Voice, and Treasurer District Committee Trivandrum, and our Vice Principal and Coordinator, IQAC, Mrs. Rema Devi Madam, our Director, CDC, Mr. Jidesh K.S., our Director, IT Cell, Mrs. Fabjan Yusuf, and our Dean of Students Welfare, Mrs. Shiva Mihail Madam, and our IT Cell team, Mrs. Jinesh Virambaran, Pansim, Jay Stone, and Anandu. I also express my deep gratitude to Dr. Manoharan Sir, Professor and Head Department of Statistics, University of Calicut, for arranging the class for conducting the webinar. I am happy to inaugurate the webinar. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Over to Shiva Ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Now we can start the presentation. Before start the presentation, I request all the participants, please cooperate with us, and you may please ask your doubts and queries through the chat box and comment box. Wish you all a worthwhile seminar. Over to you, Manoharan sir.
Thank you. Good evening to all of you, and a hearty greetings. Respected Principal, Mr. Maheen Emman, and respected Vice Principal, Srimati Rama Devi, who is in the twin role of IQAC Coordinator and also the Vice Principal, and Dr. Ashok Kumar, the Research Forum Director, Mr. Jidesh K.S., the CDC Director, and Mrs. Shiba Michael, who is in charge of the IT FS, and other esteemed members from the college, MES College, Irumeli, and interested members of the academia, dear participants. I am extremely honored and pleased for this opportunity to join you in this webinar in this pleasant evening. This is a webinar on a very important theme, UGC NAC accreditation strategies in institutions. And I am very glad to note that MES College Erimeli is looking forward to the first cycle of accreditation by NAC in the next year, that is 2021. As everyone knows, assessment and accreditation. Assessment means it's a way of looking at the performance evaluation, okay? And certification is what we call as the accreditation. So accreditation means a kind of a certification. So this is essentially what the NAC does. And on what framework this whole process is built on. And this is exactly what I would like to take you through. Please allow me to share my screen with some presentation slides. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
I can put it in full screen then. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Yes, so, as per the time availability, I would like to touch upon the important aspects of the revised accreditation framework, and also, if time permits, I can spend some time on the NAC, the so-called NIRF, that is the National Institutional Ranking Framework. So first, everyone is worried about the quality. In fact, quality is doing the right things and doing those things right. And this is what Philip Crosby in 1970 said. You may recall this famous personality who is articulated what is called as the Zero Defects Program at the Martin Company, Orlando, Florida, in long ago, 1960. And we have stages of quality hierarchy. At the bottom level, you have the quality control. So whether it is an educational institution or it's an industry or whatever it be, what we want is the type of product that you have. There should be a proper control, that is the quality control. Finding out the defects, finding out the shortcomings, how to make up for that and so on. And we have on the top of it, what is called as quality assurance. So there should be some kind of a mechanism to ensure this quality. And there is a quality system, and that is the whole thing what we have. And on the top, you have the quality management. So this is the these are the stages of quality hierarchy in short. Now, like your college, every institution has to respond to change. Any stakeholder would look forward to see that the college be developed as a center of learning with a total commitment to quality. The institution has to grow up in tune with the higher education policies of the country and state and take up more responsibilities towards the changing needs of learners and stakeholders in order to make it the first choice of students. At the same time, it should respond to the local as well as global trends in education and employment. The college shall make the students future ready. Let me tell you about the present state of affairs. With the revised accreditation framework, accreditation ranking. You know, the institution here means it could be a university, it could be a constant college, including autonomous colleges. And assessment and accreditation started by NAC, National Assessment and Accreditation Council, since 1994. And you may recall the first accredited university is Pondicherry University, 1999. And among the colleges, it's a St. Joseph's Evening College, Bangalore. And you have several rankings frameworks. NIRF is one among. Recently, you recall last week, the result of 2020 ranking was announced. And we have Times ranking. We have the QS World University ranking. We have the academic ranking of world universities, Shanghai, and so on. Several ranking frameworks are there. Their criterions are different as well. In India, we have got more than 800 universities and 45,000 colleges. And how many are accredited so far? 354 universities have been accredited, 7,999 colleges, and 12,999 under various cycles. So this is the present situation. And now, the main challenge with the revised accreditation framework, that is the reason why I want to show you this particular slide. With the revised accreditation framework, the grade declared institutions, by grade you can see, only less than 1%, that is exactly 0.9%, got A double plus. That is the highest grade. And only 4.4% scored above, that is A plus. That is 4.4% out of a total of 1,494 colleges and 74 universities. And when you look at your A grade, only 8.7. And what about B plus plus? It is 14.6. And when it comes to B plus, it is 17.8. And a majority of the colleges scored only B grade, that is 33.2%. And there are quite a lot of institutions who have grade less than that, that is C grade, that is 18.9, very significant percentage. 296 higher education institutions have got that. And less than that, that is the lowest grade, that is D qualifying grade, 1.5%. That is 24 higher education institutions got the D grade. So this is the current scenario. Let me spend some time on some of the problems with the higher education today. There is explosive increase in the higher education institutions and entrants. Developed countries working to expand higher education resources. Developing countries enhancing existing infrastructure to cope with the demand. That is what our universities and colleges are doing now. The globalization of education, at the same time, booming online learning, mobile learning, remote learning, and we have got the MOOC courses, massive open online courses. It's a familiar term nowadays. Several MOOC courses are nowadays available on Swayam platform, provided by more than nine different providers are there. Depending on the type of programs, like undergraduate program, postgraduate program, technical education, business, and so on. And we have ever increasing competition is also there. Universities competing for staff, good staff, faculty members, like students, particularly from abroad. And you can see in the questionnaire of the NAC, how many students are from this other state, outside the state, outside the country, and so on. And research funding, partnerships, and institutions are investing heavily in the ICT to support and maintain competitive positions. And at the same time, objectives, don't forget about the objectives under the five-year plan: access, equity, expansion, and excellence. And we, all the time, we have been embracing all these important points as well. The extraordinary evolutionary pace of IT, that is the massive open online course, Swayam program. Swayam is the short form for the study webs of active learning for young aspiring minds. And I'm sure many of the students and faculty members in MES College, Erimeli, would be doing one or other kind of programs, courses in the Swayam. And at the same time, impact of IT on all fronts in the university and colleges. The way we teach, the way we learn things, and the administration, everything. For instance, the University of Calicut is now paperless. A lot of digital initiatives are there. Likewise, colleges. There is a changed, very, very marked change that could be observed in the digitalization in the administration, in the teaching learning, and especially during the COVID time, almost all colleges are imparting or offering teaching or extending the teaching learning process through online platforms. And some people have some kind of a visual thinking, like there is going to be an open source university. That is it's a concept. A small group of world's leading comprehensive universities are to place in public domain for all to use the digital resources supporting their entire curriculum for all academic disciplines and the professional programs, along with open source versions of the software tools and platforms necessary to use these resources. And the open source platform like Moodle is a very important object-oriented platform on which you can offer courses. Now, here is a picture of the current state of India's higher education domain. There are issues of poor quality of graduates, lack skills for employability with only 10% of the graduates directly employable. And only 25% of engineering graduates are directly employable, as Infosys, an IT giant, recently has sorted out 1.3 million applicants, only to find that around 2% were qualified for jobs. So that is the kind of a situation that we face now. Quality of education delivered in most institutions is very poor, and that's what the industry people say. The challenges are surely manifold. I'm not taking you to the reasons and other things, but these are the reality. There is a huge demand supply gap, not just in terms of the number of seats available, but more so in terms of the seats available in institutions who offer quality education. And one gets a feeling of this if examine the statistics of applications received for CAT entrance exam for admissions to IIMs and the number get admission. In fact, hardly one of the 170 students who take CAT made it to the IIMs in a year. If you study the data for the last few years, this is quite evident. For IIT JEEs, 56 students are competing for one. See, this is a real problem now. About 2 lakh students compete for 77 seats available at IIMs, All India Institute of Medical Science, a premier medical institution in the country. If you look at the NITs, 9,500 seats in NIT invited more than 2 lakh applicants. Only very few seats, a lot of applications are there. So if you factor, in fact, the seat reservation students in open category face much stiff competition than indicated here. So there is a wide gap between industry and academia. There is a need for a strong bridging between them. So now the industry and the academia, they are going parallel. So there should be some kind of a bridge. And you can see that in the revised accreditation framework, all these aspects are imbibed. It is necessary to ensure the curriculum and skills in line with the requirements. Skill building is really very crucial to ensure employability. And also it is generally felt by all across all subject disciplines that tomorrow's good job, the requirement is that of a mixture of knowledge and the global professional skills. So industry has a very major role. Industry and students are expecting specialized courses to be offered so that they get the latest and best in education, and they are also industry ready and employable. So how to increase the employability and how to impart the desired skills? Now, we are living at a time when the world's most quickly evolving industry is the IT. And rapid developments in computing and communication are changing all aspects of life. Everywhere, industry is striving to make better informed and more effective decisions. And these swift changes are having significant effects on many aspects of higher education, the teaching, research directions, the applications, the way data and information are analyzed, and the way research is conducted and reported. There is a big change in all these areas. Now, it is interesting to look into how the advent of modern technology has opened up vast new possibilities of higher education. And the salient aspects of transformation of higher education are that of the knowledge explosion, globalization, high performance, workforce, diversity, technological change, knowledge transfer. Now, in the present time, institution is subjected to various forces on account of various factors. And there is a rapidly changing societal needs as well. Now, looking at the global need, half of the world's population is under 20 years old. Today, there are over 30 million people who are fully qualified to enter a university. But is there any space? No place available. This number will grow over to 100 million during the next decade. Now you will understand why UGC, the MHRD, and our state are all the time asking the education institutions to increase the gross enrollment ratio. Now, changing societal needs, economic realities, rapidly evolving technology are creating powerful market forces in the higher education enterprise. And also, if you look at the current faculty-centered monopoly, sustained university model is obviously ill-suited to the intensely competitive technology-driven global marketplace. So how well one can bring the change? And the key themes of the digital age are the exponential pace of the evolution of digital technology, the pervasive character of the internet, the relaxation of the conventional constraints of space, time, and monopoly, the pervasive character of information, changing ways we handle digital data, the growing importance of intellectual capital related to physical or financial capital. And it's very interesting to look at the evolution of computers. What are the type of computers we have been using some 10 years ago and what type of machines we have right now. And another change is in the computer-mediated human interaction. We started with the what is called as the 1D, that is a technical word, words for text, the email, telephony, and then 2D, that is images, and then graphics, video, WWD, multimedia, and we are on to the 3D. Environments, taking care of the virtual reality, distributed virtual environments, immersive simulations, and whatnot. Several things are there. Now, evolution of the net is already beyond human comprehension. It incorporates ideas and media's interactions among millions of people with a very high speed internet. The impact of IT on university and college really calls for redefining the mission on teaching, research, service to augment the following, that is creating, how to preserve, how to integrate things, then transfer and applying knowledge. Now, hence, what is meant by the university or college is a knowledge server. It's better to call it as a knowledge server, providing knowledge services in whatever form is needed by the society. So this is the present view. Now, what is the changing nature of research? We can now simulate reality. There is change from disciplinary to interdisciplinary, individual to team, that is small thing to big thing. So the change in teaching to learning is in number one, pedagogy, number two, the classroom, and we have the third one is the open learning. And we have different types of paradigms. Modern smart classrooms are there. We have blended learning, right? And nowadays, part of the blended learning is carried out by several institutions in our state as well during the COVID time. Now, we have been slowly moving from the lecture hall to the environment for interactive, collaborative learning from teacher to the designer and coach. So the classroom changed from the handicraft to commodity, from solitary students to the learning communities, from campuses to virtual distributed environments. Also, there is drastic change in learning from teacher-centered to the learner-centered, from passive students to the active learner. And I'm not taking you through the current problem of engaging students. Nowadays, it's very difficult to engage a student, say, more than 10 minutes. It's very difficult. Okay, so what I want to say is that the higher education, achieving excellence in higher education, this is what everyone wish to have. Grand goals of education, the very purpose is changed. Earlier, the purpose is kind of as philosophical. Now we are more towards the practical. What is the essential difference? The philosophical means learning to be. Olden days, we were having this attitude, philosophical attitude, that is learning to become, that is man-making, character-building education was there. But what we have now, it's practical, learning to do, that is economic, job-oriented education. So this is the reason why we are very much worried about the outcome of the program, outcome of the course, and everything would be decided by. So when you are giving a training in your college, when you are giving a training in a particular program, after successfully completing the program, what your student is supposed to do, what he is good for. This is the attitude now. So what is the outcome-based education? And I will tell you the outcome-based education. The outcome-based education is an educational approach that focuses on the graduate attributes or outcomes after completing an academic program. So definitely, these are all topics that are to be discussed in great depth. Certainly, when you look at the what is a program outcome, there should be some kind of attributes. So what are the attributes of the institution? What is the attributes of the students? So these are to be mapped so as to define what are the outcome of a program, outcome of the courses inside the program. Anyway, so OBE is a performance-based approach, offers a powerful and appealing way of reforming and managing higher education. Certainly, the emphasis is on the product. This is what I mentioned. What sort of graduate would be produced rather than on educational process? So OBE can be summed up as result-oriented thinking. And it is exactly the opposite of the earlier input-based education, where the emphasis is on the educational process. So we were all the time spending so much time on our educational process in the past. Now there is a paradigm shift. Okay, so when you look at a typical 21st century program, you can see, I told you about the institution should have certain attributes, right? Student attributes. So the very mission and vision are to be redefined. So academic institute, there should be a clear vision, mission, and program educational outcome should be specifically mentioned. And they have the, under the program, there are different courses, and the courses outcome should be specified. And now we have the evaluation part of that. You have teaching learning process. In the teaching learning process, the industry has a very major role. Active feedback from the industry and sometimes share resources. So we share resources. We have the industry is a real partner in the education process now. So the technology tools are coming from the industry. And the evaluation result analysis and all these are like, so now when you look at the 21st century program, the structure would be more or less like this. Okay, so let us look at the quality assurance. What we do? What are the requirements? What kind of a standards you can impose? So when you look at the entire institution, so this is kind of a thinking one has. All programs, we have the quality assurance of teaching staff. It should be there, right? Learning resources and student support. And what are the mechanisms we have? And the information systems, public information, how good it is. And how do the institutions do the assessment of students? Formal mechanisms for approval, periodic review, monitoring of the programs and awards. Policy and procedures for quality assurance. So all these things are to be looked into when you look at the quality assurance. So certainly, majority of all this would be imbibed in the revised accreditation framework. So your college, MES College, Erumeli, is starting for the first cycle. So the quality level, so this is a very famous cycle, the so-called quality cycle. It's a quality improvement cycle proposed by Schwartz cycle. That is the plan, do, check, and act. You can see each time we are doing that. So this is the first cycle, second cycle, and we are moving towards excellence. So this is the quality improvement techniques. So the willingness to adopt changes is a very important point. The system should change with the times and learn from others who are doing better. No harm in learning from your neighboring colleges, other colleges in the state who are doing better. And you share the experience, brace up for the challenge from the competition, impact of internet or IT, sophistication of technologies, constant response to stakeholders' preferences. That is also very important. Who are the stakeholders? What are the responses? Don't we have to consider their responses? Our students, alumni, our industry partners, and at the same time, what are the global demands? So we should have some willingness to adopt changes. Then only we can progress. So National Assessment and Accreditation Council has proposed the general framework based on the five important core values. Very important one. Number one, contributing to the national development. So what is, in what way your institution is contributing to the national development? You can see there are different criteria, and inside each criteria you can see different sub-criteria. That is the key indicators and questions based on that. And some of them would be towards this first core value, that is the national development. If you verify these questions, you can very easily understand. Now, second is the fostering global competencies among students. And third one is the inculcating value system among students. The value system, that's very important now in the present time, especially. Now, promoting the use of technology. How well you are using the technology for the teaching learning process, for the administration, everything in your college, and also quest for excellence. So these are the five important general, that is the core values based on which the NAC has proposed the revised accreditation framework. Okay, so before entering into the framework, Let me first tell you about what is the change from our earlier assessment process, assessment and accreditation process, and the new framework. First one is certainly the qualitative peer judgment to data-based quantitative evaluation. So qualitative peer judgment, earlier 100% qualitative peer judgment was there. A group of a peer team would come to the institution, and earlier you were submitting the self-study report, and they have their personal, sometimes, most of the time, some personal bias sometimes. And there was a lot of complaints regarding the way the peer team were doing this in several institutions in the state as well as outside. And now that is stopped. Now we have the data-based quantitative evaluation. Please note that more than, it's about 70% is quantitative. That is, your institution, whatever data you are giving, based on that, the quantitative metrics would be computed, and the 70% would be by way of this quantitative metrics. Only 30% would be qualitative. That is, the peer team will come to your institution and they will determine only 30% of that, roughly. Anyway, I will give you the details. Now, the revised accreditation towards simplification of the process. Earlier, an institution has to submit what is called as a self-study report, which may consist of more than 1,000, 2,000 pages sometimes. Now, you are not supposed to submit the hard copies, only soft copies, everything online. So towards the simplification of the process. Now, introduction of the pre-qualifier for peer team visit. That is, once you submit the data, the system will, or the machine will compute. There is a process I will tell you about that. And they will compute what is the score. If you qualify for 30% score, then only the peer team will come in and inspect or visit the institution and go for the qualitative assessment. Then introduction of the system generated score with online evaluation, that is 70%, and peer judgment 30%. Now we have third party validation of data. Don't think that NAC itself is computing all the quantitative metrics and evaluating the 70% of that. No, it's entirely the third party validation of data and the 100% offsite evaluation. That is, if you are successfully, as I told you, the Schwartz quality circle, if you undergo the third cycle, the fourth cycle, you are just supposed to submit the SSR, and it is 100% offsite evaluation. Only based on the data that you supply, your grade would be given, and no peer team visit to the institution. Now, when does it appear? The revised accreditation framework came into existence on 27th July 2017. Now, India has one of the largest and diverse education systems in the world, as you know. Widespread expansion, increased autonomy, and introduction of programs in new emerging areas have improved access to the higher education. At the same time, it has also led to widespread concern on quality and relevance of the higher education. So in fact, to alleviate this problem, by a National Policy on Education, that is NP 1986, the program of action spelled out the strategic plans for the policies, and that is how the National Assessment and Accreditation Council came. It was established in 1994 as an autonomous institution of the University Grads Commission, which is headquarters in Bangalore. The mandate of NAC, as reflected in its vision statement, is making quality assurance an integral part of functioning of the higher education. Now we mentioned about the core values and the assessment and accreditation framework of NAC, contributing to national development, fostering global competencies among students, inculcating value system among students, promoting the use of technology and quest for excellence. Now, it is ICT enabled, very objective, transparent, scalable and robust. So the shift is from, as I mentioned, qualitative peer judgment to data-based quantitative indicator evaluation with the increased objectivity and transparency. And also, it is towards the extensive use of ICT, confirming validity of claims, scalability, and robustness. So once you fill in the data, if you submit it, the DVV, that is the data validation verification team partner, they will go through your metric. If there is any inconsistency, they will get in touch with the institution, seek clarifications, and then corrections will be done. So it's very simple, very, very simple process. And also, this particular accreditation framework, revised one, is a highly robust one. It equally fits to university, autonomous institutions, and also constituent colleges. Whether it is a PG college or a UG college, these are that kind of a robustness is there in the framework. So in terms of the simplification of the process, drastic reduction in the number of questions. Only few questions are there if you compare with the earlier process. Size of the report is very less, very, very, very small. Then visit days, earlier 4 or 5 days were required. Now hardly 2 or 3 days. In a college, I've been to on this peer team a couple of occasions recent time. It took only 2 days for the assessment and accreditation of a college. So usually now it's 2 days for the colleges. Maybe for university, maybe 3 to 4 days. Now, you please listen to this process. Now, there are 7 criteria, 31 to 36 key indicators, because what I'm talking about is for any institution. When it comes to a college, it may be less than that, sometimes 31, or it may be 32 for autonomous like that. And key indicators are there. So we have 7 broad criteria. And among these 7, there will be 34 key indicators. We have the quantitative and the qualitative metrics are distributed in proportion of around 2/3 and 1/3. That is 2/3 quantitative and 1/3 is the qualitative. Now there is a pre-qualifier for peer team visit, as 30% of system generated score is there. So once you submit the data, they will calculate, the machine will calculate. If the score is 30% or above, then only you will be qualifying for the peer team visit. So the peer team visit will occur and they will have the evaluation for the 30% and the consolidated score and the grade would be there. Now we have the introduction of the system generated score with the combination of online evaluation about 70% and a peer judgment about 30%. And also another important point is in introducing the element of third party validation of data. NAC itself is not doing that. And also in providing appropriate differences in metrics, weightages and benchmarks to universities. Now you may ask whether are you following the same weightage or same consideration for the university and the autonomous institution and the colleges? No, they are different. So the weightage should be different, benchmarks to universities and the autonomous colleges would be different. So don't feel bad about the same criteria is applying for university, autonomous, no. So the benchmark would be different for the university, the benchmark would be different for the autonomous institution, benchmark would be different for the college, and so on. And also in revising several metrics to bring in enhanced participation of students and alumni in the assessment process. That part was not there earlier. Now, there is a new element called the student satisfaction survey. What is the opinion of the students about your institution? I will tell you about that process, what you are supposed to do for conducting that survey. The NAC will do that, but what are the things, what are the information that you have to provide to the NAC? Okay, to give a summary of this criteria, let me just present this slide. I told you there are 7 criteria uniformly for all institutions: universities, autonomous colleges, affiliated UG, PG. Key indicators, 34 for the university autonomous, for UG colleges, 31, and PG colleges, I suppose your college is a PG college, there will be 32 key indicators. And there will be 36 qualitative metrics, and 60, I told you roughly 65%, and the other would be roughly 35% like that. So qualitative is 36, whereas quantitative is 60. And altogether, there will be 96 total metrics for the PG college. Now, the 3-level accreditation process, there is a 3-level accreditation process. Okay, please look at the first level. First level would be submission of the institutional information for quality assessment. Hereinafter, I will say only IIQA, that is the short form, institutional information for quality assessment. And it is online, which is more or less similar to the letter of intent. Earlier, we were submitting the letter of intent, and now it's very similar to that, but it's an easier process. It's to be submitted online. There are only a few questions. Basically, the basic questions regarding the institution, the name of the institution, the manage and the affiliation to which university, address, and the staff, about the staff, about the how many students, very summary report would be there, that's all. And duly filled, this is the roughly the process. Anyway, you had to undergo all these things. Duly filled IAQA of eligible higher education institutions will be accepted by NAC for further processing, and others will be rejected. And NAC will communicate to the higher education institutions within 10 days. And there is a fee also, an advance amount is to be remitted at the time of submission of the IAQA. But don't worry about the fee now. Once you remit the fee, even if you are not successful at the first instance, you can again, 2 more attempts are there with the same fee. So in case of rejection of IAQA applications, specific suggestion would be given to the higher education institutions to facilitate them to resubmit the IAQA within the same window or subsequent windows. And also, an institution can reapply twice after the first attempt resulted in rejection. That is, each higher education institution is permitted 3 attempts with the same with the same window or subsequent ones with a single fee. That means if you are exhausted the 3 attempts, then a fresh application is to be done with the required fees. That's it. And now, on acceptance of the IAQA, institutions, please recall the first stage, submission of the IAQA. I'm talking about that. Now, on acceptance of the IAQA, institutions can submit the data or information online in the format provided as manuals for self-study report. Okay. Now, there will be no requirement for submission of the hard copy of the SSR. That is a self-study report. That is a major body, really. The formats for the submission of the online SSR are available on NAC website. I will give you, look at the NAC website, you can see the formats for different categories of institutions. You can see here, So this is the, I hope it's visible. This is the, you can see the revised manual for different types of institutions. For the university, for the, here it's autonomous colleges, and it is for the affiliated or conscient colleges. You can see this. So
the MAC website is not visible, sir.
It's not visible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Excuse me. It's not visible, sir.
Okay.
Only SSR submission. We can see only SSR submission. That.
Okay. Okay. I think that screen is not shared, it seems, right?
Yeah, yeah.
It is not shared, yeah.
It's not shared.
Okay, let me go back to that. Yeah, now it's visible? Yeah.
No, sir, no, sir.
Okay, I think it's because I'm taking you to the website of NAC.
Okay, sir. No, anyway,
you can please visit the NAC website. It's www.nac.ac.in.
Thank you,
can
sir.
Just go to the website. Carry just on, Google. Sir. Just Google. Okay, sir. Just carry Google on, it. Carry. Yeah. Okay.
Carry.
Yeah.
Okay, sir.
Now the self-study report comprises both qualitative and quantitative metrics. That is the quantitative metrics add up to about 65%, roughly. That is, I told you that it is generally for any institution, between 62.5 and 68.7%, roughly 65% quantitative metrics, and remaining is 35%. Now, 30% pre-qualifier for peer team visit, 30% of system generated score is compulsory, and institutions securing 30% of the quantitative metrics will qualify for on-site peer review assessment, and the pre-qualifier scores are exclusive of the student satisfaction survey. And student satisfaction survey is another important thing. And the data submitted on quantitative metrics will be subjected to validation exercises with the help of data validation and verification partners, that is DVV. Now the responses to the qualitative metrics will be reviewed by the peer team on site only after the institution clears the pre-qualifying stage. So that would be the second part. So the process of data validation and verification by NAC partners will be done in not more than 30 days. So any institution found to be providing wrong information, the data during the validation and the verification stage may be asked for clarification or, on their application for assessment and accreditation, and sometimes it may be rejected. So it's very important that you give very truthful and correct information. On the basis of the clarification submitted by the higher education institutions, the data will again be referred to the DVB partner for review. And don't worry about the timing. The entire process shall not exceed more than 30 to 45 days. Very quick time. Now, after getting the report from the DVV partner, NAC will intimate the result to the higher education institutions, stating that they are successfully cleared the pre-qualifier within 10 days. And this indicates that the institution has entered the next round of assessment by the peer team during their on-site visit. So we have the first stage, we have submitted the IAQA, and then followed by that, we have everything online. No hard copy. No, the SSR is submitted. Now, if there is the 30% pre-qualifier is attained, then you will be qualified for the peer team visit. So the focus of the peer team visit would be what? Only 30% of the qualitative metrics. So concurrently with the DVV, I told you there is a new thing now, student satisfaction survey. It would be conducted online by the NAC. In the pre-qualifier 30%, this will not be counted. The peer team visit shall be organized within 30 days from the date of clearing the pre-qualifier stage. So the based on the size and scope of the academic offerings, the higher education institution, the number of days and the experts for on-site visit may vary from 2 to 3 days with the 2 to 5 experts, reviewers and visitors. And there would be a database for the assessors and the peer team would be constituted, specific team would be constituted for the visit and everything would be done. Now the visit team's role would be very specific in the revised model, limited to qualitative metrics. You don't worry about the quantitative data that you have supplied. The peer team will look into the qualitative metrics. The team would play an important role in reviewing the intangible aspects. Okay, so unlike in the past, NAC will not pre-disclose the details of the visiting team. So your institution has no botheration in arranging for the stay of the people, the peer team who are coming, and even only 2 days early, only you will be informed of who are the members in the peer team. So then who is responsible for the logistics for the visiting team? It is NAC. Certainly, there would be some agencies and they will take care of all the arrangements. So the institution, don't bother about such things. The logistics would be well taken care of by the logistics for the visiting team would be well taken care of by the NAC. Now, NAC has identified external agencies to take care of the logistics for the peer team visit. Okay. So the details of various data required for filling up the online format of the self-study report. Let me sum up what are there in the self-study report. Number one, executive summary, very brief one. And there is a specific format also. You have to just go through that and then fill up the details. Now, profile of the affiliated or constant colleges. I'm talking about only matters pertaining to the colleges. Now the QIF, the quality indicator framework with the details of data in respect of each of the 7 assessment and accreditation criteria. I told you that there are 7 important criteria and the quality QIF with the details of data and what are the things you have to fill in, and that would be there. And also data templates or the documents are also available. So these are the, if you look at the manual, you can get all this information. So the executive summary means every higher education institution applying for the assessment and accreditation process shall prepare an executive summary limited to 5,000 words, highlighting the main features of the institution, including. So the IQAC team in your college has a very important role to play with. They should know. I'm very glad to know that you have a very vibrant team in the IQAC, and you had to take care of all these things. How impressive you prepare this executive summary, and introductory note on the location, institution, vision, mission, and etc. Then you can include the criterion by summary on the institution's functioning in not more than 250 words. For each of the criteria. Okay, then brief note on the SWOC, that is the strength, weakness, opportunities, and challenges in respect of the institutions. In bullet form, you can just point out what are the new features in S, that is the strength, what are the weaknesses of the institution, opportunities, and also challenges. And also you can add additional information about the institution other than the ones already mentioned here. And finally, overall conclusive explication about the institution's functioning. Some important feature you have, you can certainly, maybe socioeconomic and other, and your engagement with the society and other things. You can mention all those things. Now, there is a prescribed format, 23 items. I request all, please note that unlike earlier days, IQAC team cannot do all these things. there should be a very concerted joint effort by all the faculty members and all stakeholders of the institution to prepare for the accreditation of NAC with the revised accreditation framework. So you can refer to the manual. I told you that manual separately available for universities, autonomous colleges, and constant colleges. So you refer to the information for the manual for the constant colleges. You can get it downloaded. You go through all the important matters there, and then prepare accordingly. And you have to submit anyway online. So this will help you to submit the details online as well. Okay, so shall I go to the quality indicator framework now for affiliated colleges? Okay, so first I would like to note the following. Number one, the revised format of SSR has to be filled up only online, and the IT format would be made available on the NAC website. So once you fill up all the details in the SSR, you can get a link. You can get it downloaded. And in fact, you are supposed to, NAC will tell you or advise you to put it in your website also. NAC websites as well as in the institution website, you can show it. Now the quality QAF, the indicator framework given below presents the metrics under each key indicator for all the 7 criteria. So while going through the quality indicator framework, details are given below for each metric in the form of very specific. Anyone can very easily understand data required. Maybe you'll be asked how many, what is the total number of teachers having PhD? So you have to supply the data. Okay, so there will be a formula for calculating some information sometimes, and it will be given. And documents needed, and also you will be asked to support this number with the some of the documents. So the documents needed to be uploaded from which the data could be compiled. So these are all very clear in the online format. So this will help the institutions in the preparation of their SSR. That is, what is the importance of the items given, the kind of data to be provided, and the kind of documents to be made available, and the mode of response. Sometimes it may be a qualitative one, in which case you have to limit in 1,000 words sometimes, or 2,000 words and so on. Or it may be a quantitative data, you have to give the number and then supporting documents. So it's very important that the institution has to keep the records. All documents should be ready, because you have to, along with the number what you are supplying, you have to support it with the documents. So that is to be uploaded. For some qualitative metrics which seek descriptive data, so it is specified as to what kind of information has to be given and how it, these are, it is always advisable to keep data accordingly compiled beforehand, because it's, I told you that the manual is available in the website. You take the manual, you make everything ready with you, and then try to give the data online. For the quantitative metrics, wherever formula is given, there are about 21 formula, not very much. It must be noted that these are given merely to inform the higher education institutions about the manner in which data submitted would be used. Just for the information, in what way your data would be used and what way it is calculated and so on. Just like it may be the ratio sometimes, it may be the percentage and so on. It's not a very big formula. Don't worry about the formula once you hear the name formula. Now the metric-wise percentage weightage is also given. The actual online format may change slightly from the QAF given in the manual, which is because of rendering it to the IT format. That's all. But the, basically, the information that you'll be giving would be the same. Observe this carefully while filling up your manual. I hope this will help you to do that. So these are the seven criteria. Number one, curricular aspects. More or less the same seven criteria were there, but slight difference in the, I think the seventh one and also the third one, research innovation. Earlier it was consultancy, now it is changed to extension. Okay, so let me read it out. It's very important. Number one, curricular aspects. Then number two, teaching, learning and evaluation. And number three, research innovation and extension. Number four, infrastructure and learning resources. Five, student support and progression. And six, the governance, leadership and management. And the last one, seventh one, is the institutional values and best practices. Earlier it was just best practices. Now it's institutional values. This is also very important, and best practices. And now you may wonder in what proportion this criteria would be there. Okay, can you just guess among these seven criteria, what are the criteria that are more important to a college? That means, what are the criteria having higher weightages? For the colleges, you can note that teaching, learning, and evaluation is the highest. It's about 350 out of 1,000. And the fifth one, that is the student support and progression. That is also important, 130 weightage. And other criteria are having weightage less than that. I will tell you specifically, just give a comparison between the various aspects as well. Okay. Anyway, that means you have to concentrate more on, this is the tip I want to give you. If you are going for the accreditation, if your score here is for the first criteria, suppose it is, you have a scale between 0 to 4, okay? Your grading system would be 0 to 4 now. Now, your grade here would be multiplied by what is the weightage you are giving here. So if you're scoring very high grade in the second one, it would be multiplied by 350. So it will contribute more towards your final grading. That is why I'm telling you that you concentrate more on the teaching, learning, evaluation. That is, you should score better in the second category as well as the fifth category. It doesn't mean that you are not you forget about the other things, but you should have a very reasonable score in the other criteria as well. Anyway, concentrate more on among the seven. Concentrate more on the second one and the fifth one for the constituent colleges. But when it comes to the university, I will tell you that the first, second, and third are important. The weightages are more for the first, second, and the third. That is the curricular aspects, the teaching, learning, and evaluation, and research, innovation, and extension. Okay, just to give a sample, I will not have time to take you through all the criteria, but I just give a sample here. This is the form you will have anyway. For among criteria number one, curricular aspects. You can see different sub-criteria, in the key indicators are this, different, that is different sub-criteria, that is 1.1. U here represents for universities only. A for curriculum planning implementation, that for autonomous. For other constant colleges, these two are not there, okay? So applicable only to the university, only to the autonomous institution. And here 1.2 is applicable to you, that is academic flexibility. And 1.3 is the curriculum enrichment. And 1.4 is the feedback system. I hope you understand the sub-criteria here. Okay, so likewise, you may have a different criteria, seven criteria, there will be different sub-criteria, and there would be different questions under each category. and you'll be giving some of the questions maybe of the quantitative nature, some may be qualitative nature. You have to supply the data. Okay. So now you can, there is a manual. I think I can spend 1 or 2 minutes on this PDF version here. Is it visible? No, is it visible?
No, sir.
I think only PowerPoint slides are getting shared. Anyway, okay. So what I'm trying to show you is the under criterion one, there are sub criteria. These are all available in the manual. I'm just taking a few pages out of the manual. That's all. Just to give a sample of the qualitative matrices as well as the quantitative matrices. That is, for instance, you have the first question. I told you that the curricular planning and implementation. So for instance, curriculum planning and implementation, the weightage is 20. So the 20 would be divided into different categories. Number one, institution ensures effective curriculum delivery through a well-planned and documented process. So it is certainly a qualitative one, right? So you have to give a description of the initiatives of the college in not more than 500 words, that's all. And that has 10 weightage. And number two is the quantitative type. That is the number of certificates or diploma programs introduced during the last 5 years. Very simple. So what is the data requirement? That is also given below that. That is the certificate, diploma, or program code, name of the program, year of introduction. That's all. You have to just give them. And that has 5 points. So likewise, you may have quantity. And another question is percentage of participation of full-time teachers in various bodies of the university or autonomous colleges or other colleges such as BOS, Board of Studies, Academic Council during the last 5 years. So if it is pertaining to a college, you can give the data. And also please note that there is a allowance for the institution to withdraw from at the most 50 weightages. So if some of the questions are not really pertinent to you, you can avoid that. And you can avoid, say, up to 50 weightages out of the total 1,000. So that is also possible. Anyway, that is the quality indicator framework. And see the manual for the, you have the Word version as well as the PDF version. I hope it's clear to you how the SSR is submitted and the process. Okay, now, if it is a PG college, then you are supposed to give evaluative report of the department. There would be different departments certainly, right? So please recall that in early days, earlier, we were submitting the self-study report of different departments separately. That means for English department, there would be a kind of a book thing, maybe 50 or 100 pages like that. The information from the department would be given. But now that is simplified. You can see here, just a spreadsheet would be there, Excel kind of a sheet, and one column, you can see the questions here, 15 questions. You have to answer these 15 questions regarding each department. For instance, English department, you can see year of establishment give. Is the department part of which faculty or school like that? Name of the program offered, name of the teaching post, sanctioned, filled, number of research projects, then about the citation index, impact factor, the quality of publication and so on. And likewise, the next column is for another department. It's just an example. So you can see English. Now next column is for zoology, biotechnology, and so on. So if what are the departments you are having, you retain a column, okay, for each department and supply the answers to the questions given on the left side. That's all. So, and this is also to be done online. There is a Excel kind of a sheet, each department. So only thing is that you have to ready with the data, that's all, concerning each department. I hope it's clear. Now, having said so, the data validation and verification and the pre-qualified score. So this, at the second level, the data information submitted in the SSR will be subjected to the online assessment mechanism process with the data validation verification. And I told you there is what is called as a pre-qualified scores. This is exclusive of the student satisfaction survey. So I would like to tell you about the student satisfaction survey. So the introduction of the student satisfaction survey is new as an attempt to engage students in the quality assurance process. So the students are playing an important role in the assessment process, right? The student satisfaction survey will be conducted concurrent to the DVB. The scores obtained in the SSS will be part of the overall CGPA or the criterion-wise grade point average. For taking the SSS, institutions will be required to submit the details of all students enrolled in the institution. So suppose you are submitting in 2021, that means from 2015 to 20, that is the last 5 years, who are the students studied in this department? The details of the students enrolled in the institution, enrollment number, what is the program, year of study, the email ID, and the mobile number. Okay, so there is a sheet online available. You have to submit or upload the sheet. So what is being done by NAC? So NAC will randomly select students for a survey. And there is a survey that is about 20 objective type questions on the Likert scale, ABCD is given. And one descriptive question is there, finally, about your opinion about or how well you can improve the teaching, learning, and so on, their suggestion. And what are the data you have to provide or the student has to provide? The quality of teaching, the teaching learning, their experience, all questions, different types of questions, whether the teacher is finishing the portions, syllabi, how effective it is. And there are 20 questions like that. And then finally, the suggestion. So this would be, so what I want to say is that the institution has to take care of the students very well. How well you communicate to the students, how effective is the teaching learning process? Their sincere opinion would be given to the NAC directly. You have no role on that. Okay, so 10% of the students would be selected randomly, and then the questionnaire would be communicated to them, and their response would be collected by the NAC, and then there is a weightage of, you'll be very surprised to know, there's a very heavy weightage for the affiliated colleges, that is 60. So 60 weightage by way of the student satisfaction survey. When it comes to autonomous, it is 50. And I remember for the university, it is about 30. So you had to make sure that your teaching learning process is very well, and it is very effective to the students. Okay, so the last part of this is the on-site assessment. I told you that only qualitative metrics would metrics would be assessed by the peer team, and that would be done in 2 to 3 days with the between 2 and 5 experts in general. And then what and also the on-site assessment of the qualitative metrics of the SSR by the visiting team, resulting in generation of the qualitative report of the institution with the SWOT analysis. And the role would be very specific in the revised model, limited to the qualitative metrics assigning scores as per the performance on each of the qualitative metric. And also on completion of the on-site evaluation, NAC will combine the scores. So what we have is the system generated score is there, and student satisfaction survey, and that score is there. Okay, then the peer team will come and assess. 30% is there. So all these scores with the appropriate weightage would be combined by NAC. And then finally, the criterion-wise grade point average would be calculated. And that gives you the grade final. Okay, so the final outcome on approval of Executive Council of NAC, the accreditation status and the institutional grade would be declared. Okay, well, I think I have given you the important process in this one. Okay, now a few important points. The peer team report, how does the peer team report would look like? Section 1 gives the general information. That is the structure. Section 2 gives the criteria wise analysis based on the peer evaluation. And section 3 presents the overall analysis, which will include the institutional strength, weakness, opportunities, and challenges. It may be given in bullet form. And the final records, that is section 5, is recording the recommendations for quality enhancement of the institution, not more than 10 major ones. That will give you an idea where, what are the gray areas? What are the points you have to improve upon? And what are the good things? And all those things will be mentioned. Okay, so part 2, that is the system generated quality profile of the higher education institutions based on the statistical analysis of the quantitative indicators. And also graphical representation would be there, because these are all data-based. It's very easy to show different features, and some graphical representation is also given. And part 3 is containing the institutional grade sheet, which is based on the qualitative indicators, quantitative indicators, and the student satisfaction survey. That is the consolidation of everything. Okay, so the above 3 parts will together form the NAC accreditation outcome document. Okay, so it is mandatory for the higher education institutions to display it on their institutional website, apart from the NAC hosting it in its website. So you are supposed to, your institution is supposed to display it in your website. Finally, the grading pattern. If you look at the grading pattern, the introduction of the grade qualifiers, the CGPA, I told you that the highest grade is A++ accredited. That is 3.7624 is A++. And 3.51 to 3.75 is A+. And 3.01 to 3.5 is A. And now you can see B starts from 2 to 2.5, then 2.5 to 2.7, then 2.76 to 3 is B++. Now, less than 2, that is 1.51 to 2 is C, and less than 1.5 is D, not accredited. Okay, so the lowest accredited grade is C, that is, it is between 1.51 and 2. Now, a system of applying minimum qualifier for achieving a grade has been designed and will be implemented. For example, colleges should score a minimum of CRGPA, that is the credit, the criterion wise credit point average of 3.01 in criteria 2 and 5 for achieving A plus or A++ grade. I hope you understand this. That is, I told you that criterion 2 and 5 are very important. Okay. If you are not achieving, for instance, A grade in 2, that is, suppose you are getting B++ in criterion 2, but you are getting A grade in all other criteria, okay, then you will not get the A grade. Okay, so the college should score a minimum CRGPA of 3.01 in criteria 2 and 5, because 2 and 5 are important for the colleges. In the similar manner, if it's for a university, in criteria 1, 2, and 3, the university should have at least a 3.01 in order to qualify for A plus or A++ grade. Similarly, it's the case with the B. Anyway, this is what we have. So that minimum 2.01 in criteria 2 and 5 for B plus, and B++. So similarly, the last one, this for C grade, minimum is 1.51 in criteria 2 and 5. Then only it will qualify for the C grade. Okay, so this is generally the NAC assessment accreditation process. I hope you can see the IAQA application and SSR preparation. Okay, then the process goes on like this, and the SSR would be verified by the DVV partner, and then the score would be completed, and then along with that, the student satisfaction survey would be conducted, and we have the assessment by the PAT, and all together this would be combined, and then we have the final score. Okay, I think the time allotted to me is now over. I think we can go ahead for the questions. If you have any questions, I would be very glad to take it.
Okay, sir. You are very impressive, informative, and inspiring presentation, sir. And there occur so many questions from the audience. And I request Mr. Jitesh KS to convey some of the queries.
Okay.
Over to you, Jitesh.
Good evening, sir.
Okay, please.
Sir, we have so many queries from our participants. We would like to know about NIRF ranking. Sir, can you explain something related to NIRF?
Oh, sure. Yeah. Any other queries, please? Yeah.
Yes. We have some in...
regarding NAC, I think first we will dispose about the NAC, and then we will go to the NIRF. Yeah.
Okay. Sir, yes. Sir, it is essential for each department in an organization need its own vision and mission. Each department in a college or institution need their own vision and mission.
Certainly, because each program will have their own vision and mission, but the whole institution will have a general mission.
Okay.
So the graduate attributes should be based on that, really.
Okay.
And then discipline centric, the attribute would be slightly different, but the objective, the mission and mission of the institution would be there. And under that, each department can have their own vision and mission.
Okay, right, sir.
But there should be a clear mapping between the vision and mission of the respective departments and the institution.
Sir, you mentioned earlier related to certification courses conducted by the organization. Sir, can you give the idea of certification courses? Is it necessary for organizing outside agency or inside the college organize its own certification courses? Is essential for these conditions?
Which certification you are talking
certification,
about?
Certification. Some of certification courses is needed for diploma certification courses is needed. Sorry, you mentioned earlier, diploma certification needed for college wise.
Yeah,
I think it's on best to practice.
You see, UGC, the quality mandate is now there are apprehensions about the outcome, certainly. So after doing the programs, I just mentioned at the start, the majority of the students are not employable after graduation, right? So how to increase the employability? So there comes this kind of a problem. And you may recall the UGC has proposed various vocational courses, BVoc courses. So what they do is, it is a real blending with the industry. The students can get enrolled. After 6 months, they may qualify for some kind of a certificate course. After 1 year, it is a diploma. After completing 6 semesters, they will qualify for the degree. But these are the real partner is the industry. So after doing this program, successful completion of the program, the students should be employed in the industry. So in order to, so that kind of a skill would be important, and then you can improve upon. Your college can certainly think about such very interesting programs so that your students will be get absorbed into the industry straight away after completing the program. So that means that will really meet the purpose of education.
Okay, so most of the participants raised the questions related to best to practices. Sir, can you give some examples for best to practices?
Best practices, it depends on the kind of a institution. Maybe your institution is more inclined towards some social inclusiveness. Okay, that may be a best practice. Or environmental concern, okay? So okay. What are the initiatives that you are taking? Or even water harvesting or solar energy? So these are some of the examples I'm talking about. Yes. And obviously you can, it depends on the kind of a geographical position your college is and in what way you are taking the initiatives. It may be green practice sometimes, right? So energy, how well you, sometimes you can generate electricity in your college and you can help others as well. So in what way you are helping the society? So these are all best practices.
What we contributed to the national development, that is, I think.
Yes, the societal needs. So because the institution means, institution must be more caring about the society.
Yes.
So then only the very purpose of education would be there.
Thank you, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir. Yeah. Then how influenced the NAC ranking of an institution international level? If we got A+ or something rank, then how it reflects?
No, please understand that NAC, it is a national accreditation framework. So, but certainly, there is a name, no? When they search, NAC is very important. And also they, with the revised accreditation framework, it is well accepted. So the grade of NAC would be counted very much outside as well. But as such, there is a, I told you about the Times ranking, QS ranking, and the World University ranking, and there are several other rankings as well.
Okay, thank you, sir. Then, how sir, how can we distinguish value-added courses and certification courses? Question based on affiliated colleges. So some of the college offers us value-added courses and some certification courses. Is it necessary or is it important for NAC accreditation?
Whatever kind of course, whether it's a value-added, it is always important.
Yes.
So it counts much really. NAC, you can score some marks also by way of that. So that would be counted. It's always welcome to introduce such courses. Yeah.
Sir, one of the other questions is, when we fix the mission and vision, if we change in according to our nature or some in future years, it may be a facility to change our vision or mission. Suppose nowadays we have moved to online education.
Yes, then, correct. It's a good question, really. Yeah, it's a good question. I told you that the influence of, say, information technology, or maybe the technology is has changed the perspective, teaching, learning, and everything now. So even the very vision is to be redrafted, right? So the institution may have a earlier some vision and mission. Now, what is our target? And that is changed now. So accordingly, we'll have to revise the mission and mission. It's a good question anyway, especially when the, what is the kind of a delivery? We are having different online platforms on which you are giving the classes, right? So these are all important things.
Sir, also then a question related to SWAYAM courses or the MOOC courses. Sir, yeah. is it necessary for DAC accreditation? So SWAYAM courses for UG and PG students?
NAC is certainly is an autonomous body under UGC, and UGC, MHRD, they are taking very good initiative for encouraging more students for taking up the SWAYAM courses. Okay, that is the MOOC courses. And the important point here is there is what is called as a regulation. Most of the universities have already endorsed these regulations. For example, Calicut University has implemented that regulation. Accordingly, a student can take 20% of the courses in a semester. That means that if there are 5 courses in a semester, then one can be a MOOC course. Now, during the COVID time, it is increased to now one more. That is 2 courses can be MOOC. So the credit transfer is also allowed. So if a student he prefers to take a course from SWAYAM platform, and that would be counted as part of the program. So there is going to be a lot of students are now getting enrolled into the SWAYAM, and it may not be for as part of the program. Even my relatives, maybe my son, my father, my grandfather, anyone can take.
Yes, right? Yes.
It's a, there is no, that is a, the philosophy is AAA. That is anyone, anytime, anywhere.
All right.
And you can learn that, right? So there is constraint. There is no constraint for taking up the NAC courses. If it is a part of the program, well, it would be counted. And it may be having some weightage, also some credits. So 4 credit course. So as a part of a specific program, the student can get it and get that credit transferred as well. So the provision is there anyway.
Sir, one more question is how to fix the program outcomes and the course outcomes for affiliated colleges? Majority of our universities are fixes the program outcomes and the course outcomes. There is no role for affiliated colleges.
No, it would be the same. No, it would be the same. The program outcome means, say, BSc Mathematics or maybe BSc Physics. So after doing the program, what is outcome? So the program outcome should be given. What the student is expected to do after doing the program, right? So that would be there. It may be different outcomes. So usually PO1, PO2, PO3, and so on. Now several institutions have already gone ahead in preparing this program outcome and course outcome and so on. So under the program, different courses would be there. Each course will have different course outcomes as well.
Okay, thank you.
So don't think that these are different for different institutions, but it may be different from country to country. Maybe if you are offering, your college is offering, say, MCOM program, right? MCOM program, the outcome, program outcome may be different from the program outcome that one has in other country. Maybe slight difference would be there. But within the country, within the state, all programs would be more or less the same. So the outcome should be the same. That is what I expect.
Sir, how many IQCCL meeting we must have before applying for first year NAC?
In fact, before applying the first cycle, there is no insistence, but after first cycle, it is a must. You should have an IQAC. I'm very glad to note that your college has gone ahead and having a very vibrant IQAC cell as well. And,
right.
And I know that Rama Devi is capable of leading from the front. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Yeah. Then we have so many questions, but the time is not allowing to ask these questions.
Anyway, I can spend some time on NIRF also.
Okay, sir. Just can you?
I have a slide. I can just share my slide also. Okay. Okay, can you just hear it?
Yeah.
The National Institution Ranking Framework was approved and launched by the MHRD on 29th September 2015. And this framework outlines the methodology to rank institutions across the country. The methodology is based on the broad parameters for ranking various universities and institutions. Okay, now, the first 2016 ranking was the first attempt, and then now you have a 2020 ranking also came out. Now, the parameters broadly cover the teaching, learning and resources, research and professional practices, number two. Number three is the graduation outcomes. Number four is the outreach and inclusivity, and fifth is the perception. And first, you note that it is not quantitative. Okay, qualitative. It is only quantitative. Some data would be asked. You are giving the data. Based on that, there is a benchmark, and this computation is done, and the ranking would be given. And the weightage for these five important criteria are different for different institutions as well. I will tell you about that also. So, these are all available in the MHRD website, the NIRF website. You can see, just Google NAC NIRF, you can see this. And I'm very happy to tell you that in 2020 ranking, University of Calicut has improved very much, and we are 54th rank among all universities in the country, and at the 76th overall. Okay, thank you. Yeah, the teaching, learning and resources, you can see the student strength, including doctoral students, is counted. You can just note down these important points. The student strength, including doctoral students. Then faculty-student ratio is asked. Combined metric for faculty with the PhDs. How many people are having PhD among the faculties? And experience and financial resources and their utilization. So these are coming under the first category. Second one, research and professional practices. This is the area where majority of the institutions are lagging behind. You can see from the score that those institutions have. Assessment is based on primary data, on the third party data pertaining to combined metric for the publications. Good publications, faculty should produce good publications in standard journals with a very good impact factor. So combined metric for quality publications is the, then IPR, patents, how many filed, how many published, all this is count. Now, the footprint of projects, professional practices, and so on. So this is the second one, very important one. Then graduation outcome. The graduation outcome is based on primary data pertaining to metrics for university examinations, 60 marks. And metric for the number of PhD students graduated is 40 marks. So it goes like that. And then Outreach and inclusivity means the questions would be person students from other states. You understand the question, like the earlier question, the region diversity. How many students are there from other states, other countries? Now, percentage of women, right? That is a also inclusivity, diversity, women diversity is counted. Then economically and socially challenged students, how many are there? So that will, if the number is more, you will get better grades. Now, facilities for physically challenged students. Do you have facilities in the college? Then you can score. Then finally, the perception. Peer perception, that is academic peers and employers. That is, there is a huge database and some questions would be sent. And the opinion of the people about the institution. So MES College, Erimeli, how do the industrial partners or how do the academic peers and how well the alumni and other people outside, people think about the institution. So the perception. So based on that, that is the last part. Okay. So roughly, this is the kind of a data, and also there is a cross verification also. I'm sure that the All India Survey on Higher Education, you are familiar with, your college would be having some nodal officer also. All the data would be given and they will cross check the NIR of agency will cross check with the Asia data, and accordingly the this would be computed. And I will give you the important distinction between the NAC and the NIRF. I told you that the NAC is grading. You have A++, A+, and so on grading, but here only ranking. That is the annual event. And the other is for a specific period, it may be valid for 5 years. Okay. So accreditation period 5 years, and it's ranking only for 1 year. And there are a lot of distinction between the NAC and the NIRF. And I told you that this is the point, that is the teaching learning is 40% for the college. I'm talking about only colleges here. And research productivity and impact, the weightage is 0.15. And graduation outcome is very high, 0.25. If you score very good here, the overall contribution would be better. And the teaching learning, you can score very high here. And that will contribute more for the college because you are multiplying by 0.4. And outreach is, inclusivity is 0.1, that is 10%. And similarly, the perception is also 10%. And the governance leadership, they don't count. There is no place in the NIRF. Institution values and best practices, no place for that. So only perception is there. Okay, so based on that, also there are different other ranking schemes. Times ranking is there, QS ranking is there, the academic ranking of world universities, Shanghai is there. You can see various types of ranking framework and different criterions are also proposed. Okay, I think that's good.
Yes, sir.
I think it's the questions are answered fully, it seems.
Yeah, sir.
Okay, thanks a lot. I thank you for all the organizers of this institution for giving you an opportunity to interact in this evening, and thanks to the moderator who has done excellently. For more than 2 hours, I think more than 2 hours now in this webinar. Thanks a lot. All the best for your college for the coming NAC accreditation process.
Okay, sir. Thanks. Thanks from the part of audience. And you have cleared all the doubts that are likely to occur during the NAC accreditation process, sir. And shall we wind up, sir?
Sure, thank you.
Yeah. Okay, for a formal vote of thanks, I invite CDC Director, Mr. Jitesh K.S. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Shubha ma'am. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
An investment in knowledge pays the best interest. It's a word of Benjamin Franklin. It is really great that this national webinar turned out to be very successful. I am Jidesh. I am here to present the vote of thanks to the people who made this event successful. I would like to take a minute and thanks all of them. All of us know about NAC and its accreditation, but it is not a simple task. An institute go for accreditation first time, feel not better. It is like a Herculean task. But we have a strategy, we can do it. This idea, our IQC kept in mind and planned to organize a webinar on it. We got absolute right eminent person for it. First of all, I would like to thank our respected resource person, Dr. Manoharan sir, Professor, Department of Statistics, University of Calicut. Thank you for your wonderful session. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I also want to thank our respected principal, Mahina Man sir, for taking effort to make the national webinar possible. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, thank you.
This event would not have been successful without a teamwork. Our team, IQAC, ITSL, Research Forum, all these three teams have worked for organizing webinars in our college. I thank and I would like to appreciate the efforts from the part of IQAC coordinator and vice principal, Mrs. Rema Devi Madam, for organizing webinars. Also appreciate IQAC team. This is our 10th webinar. It's related to the final one is related to NAC. It is not possible to explain the hard work behind the webinar. The major effort contributed by our IT cell. I express my sincere gratitude to our IT cell director, Mr. Sabjan Yusuf, and his teammates, Tanseem, Jinesh, and the faculties of Electronics Department, Jaisar and Anandusar. Then I express sincere gratitude to our students dean, Shiba Madam, for unextended support for organizing this webinar. Another specially mentioned name, Dr. Ashok Kumar sir, Director, Research Forum. He serves to us intellectual and motivational supports. Thank you, Ashok Kumar sir, Shiba ma'am. Also, I thank all the faculties contributed efforts made its success. Last but not least, I thank all the participants from various institutions across the India for your cooperation and made this event a successful completion. We feel proud and thank you for making us feel happy with your presence to this webinar. Once again, thank you very much to all who joined here. Thank you.
Thank you. It was a pleasure being with you. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, thanks. Thank you. Welcome.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.